busy digging around for a bit of family history and working up a fine appetite for the festivities to come is Chef Derry Clark. Now, you might have known Birr Castle was famous for its telescope, but did you know it was also pretty well renowned for its watercress?
This here behind me is the well of St. Brendan the Elder, one of the 12 original disciples of St. Patrick, who founded the monastery here in Birr that was behind the foundation of the town of Birr today. This is the well from which the water flows down now under where we're standing into the pond, from which we have gathered the watercress ever since. This is the watercress pond, and it can be very slippery.
It seems the Irish word for watercress is bjuller, from which we get burr. Who knew?
And when's the best time of the year for cress?
We can get it any time of the year except in July when it's in flower, because the little white flowers on it are not too good. Brings through a comment to the viewers. Good to see his lordship on his knees.
I just feel a bit constrained by history. I want to throw off the shackles a bit.
Another minor constraint at the moment is the lack of actual ingredients. It's very difficult to make roast rabbit with a pudding in the belly without, say, a rabbit.
Hello, chefs.
Oh, hi, Catherine. Hello. How are you?
Oh, my goodness.
More work. That's all I see.
Do you know what I think I got the hardest job this week? I had to take the skin off the little bunny, which was really... I was way out of my comfort zone.
The two Seamuses may have plucking machines and the like, but they absolutely didn't have them back in the 1600s. So to stay just a little bit true to the times, Catherine is going to have to do a bit of plucking and a bit of skinning.
Seamus, I'm just telling you now, I am so far out of my comfort zone. I mean, I would say step one, get in the car and drive as fast as I can in the other direction. But anyways, right, here we go. So I'm pulling it this way.
Yeah, pulling it this
giving
way.
Giving it a good pull, yeah.
That's it, we're removing the skin from the back there now. Yeah.
It's because it's fur that I'm having a problem here, Seamus.
Right. Yeah.
The original recipe was for hare, but given the precarious state of the hare population in Ireland, we've opted to go with rabbit. The Irish hare is one of the few native species of mammals, whereas rabbits were introduced in the 12th century by the Normans as a self-propagating food supply. At one point, we had huge numbers of rabbits in Ireland, but the deliberate introduction of myxomatosis in the early 50s wiped out about 95% of the population. Rabbit numbers have never really recovered, but overall, they aren't in danger. The same can't be said for the hare. We tend not to eat hare in Ireland anymore, just trap them in fields and chase them with greyhounds.
This is quite brutal. Up over the head like this?
That's it, yeah.
Oh my goodness.
Do you want me to do that?
No, I'll go for it.
Put your hand in there now and pull out what's in there. Take a deep breath.
I'm not going to look now, because if I look, I think I'll... That's on my hand, go straight to the bucket. Poor Finn owes me big time after this. Big time!
Were you singing, do you remember that song?
Bright eyes, burning like fire.
Oh, Paul, it was a horrible job. Yeah, I felt so bad doing it. Yeah. And with the pheasant, I plucked the pheasants for you.
Oh, my gosh.
And I also, first time ever in my life, I actually took the innards out. So for me, it was a learning curve.
How many have you got?
I have about three. How many do you need?
Three would do me.
Okay.
Make a pie. I'll start
Do you need some help?
Soon.
Will I go get changed?
I really do.
Okay,
let me get
changed, get my apron on. I'll leave those there for you.
I'm going to do the pheasants, okay?
One of the showstoppers on tonight's menu is a baked pheasant pie. Pies were an extremely popular way of preparing food in the days when the regulation of heat in your cooker was primitive, to say the least. Even the giant Aga here in Birr, the instructions were it had to be able to fit a suckling pig, has temperature control issues. Today's baked pheasant pie involves boning out the birds and baking them, along with minced beef, suet, egg yolks, parsley, thyme, chives, marjoram, grapes, rashers, and orange juice. Oh, and ground nutmeg. Nutmeg is a really popular ingredient in these old recipes. On its own, the baked pheasant pie would feed a good-sized family. But history and our menu demands that our pie will very much not be on its own.
Do you know what, sweetbreads? We should be blanching the sweetbreads.
Yeah, well, can we leave those for the moment?
No. Let's get them done and done.
I think, actually, you're putting it all under too much pressure. You're putting the ovens.
What do you mean the ovens under too much pressure? I'm under pressure. What?
No, you're not under pressure. can't get those things down there.
No, I do want to get the sweepers done. Don't be annoying me now. I mean, the thing about it is, once this is done and on, I feel better.
You'll be relaxed.
And you want me to feel better, don't you?
Oh, I really want you to feel better, yes. It makes life so much easier when you feel better.
Oblivious to the growing stress levels in the kitchen, Derry is enjoying a leisurely stroll through the grounds of Birr Castle in the company of Alicia Clements, the daughter of Lord and Lady Ross. Derry has his eye on a structure that is still one of the most famous man-made objects in the scientific world.
Coming in here today, Alicia, looking at this is amazing, quite spectacular. Who built this?
This telescope was built by the third Earl of Ross in the 1840s. He built it because he had the largest telescope in the world already here, located behind me, a 3-foot telescope. And having used it for a couple of years, he decided it wasn't big enough, so he wanted a bigger one. So he doubled it all in one go. The technology involved in building this was unheard of. People came from all over the world here to help him build it and learn about metal technology in order to build the mirror. So for 75 years, if you wanted to see further in space than anywhere else in the world, you would have to come to Birr.
This is the formal portrait of my twice great grandfather, William III Earl of Ross, proudly wearing his blue ribbon of the Order of St. Patrick. Rather a nice picture, I think, of him. Opposite his wife, Mary Field, she was born, a great, great benefactor who really was the one who enabled her husband to indulge in his passion to see further into space than anyone else had ever been able to do before.
Mary Ross, née Field, the daughter of a wealthy Yorkshire landowner, was one of the great benefactors of her or any age. As well as the construction of the Leviathan of Parsonstown, as the giant telescope was known, she also masterminded a famine recovery plan that employed several hundred people from the town and surrounds, as well as being a pioneer of the new art of photography. These photographs of the telescope you're seeing now, she took them, and she designed and forged the gates in the lodge she also designed and built, because as well as everything else, she was a qualified blacksmith. Mary Ross is my new hero.
In those days, people didn't just drop in. They would have to stay for days, weeks, and even months in order to make their discoveries and to find the perfect night to observe whatever they were observing in the sky. So Mary Ross had to do what all Victorians did. She had to build herself a very large kitchen, a huge dining room, and I imagine endless dinner parties where you were kind of going, have the clouds cleared? And just as all the food's being served, everyone going, clouds are cleared, we're off. And it all sitting there and finding ways to keep it warm and not spoil and wait for the astronomers to come back in at 3 o'clock in the morning.